Okay. So, hello and welcome to today's Boss Constructor Dev Stream. Today I'm going to implement the next module which was voted for in the service. And this is the linked armor module proposed by Dazeneth. And what does it do? Well, it is an armor module, and the idea is that if you have multiple of these armor modules adjacent to each other, they will sort of share the damage they receive. So the first module which gets hit transmits a portion of the damage to adjacent modules, and yeah, it's gonna be pretty sweet, I think. So, as usual, let's begin by making a brief, like agenda for what we will do. First, we're going to create the graphics. Second, we're going to add it to the game. Next, we're going to add the functionality of the module. Next, we will add some little effects, and yeah, finally we're going to test it and deploy it. I'm not sure if I'm going to deploy it immediately after doing this stream because I have some more stuff on my to-do list which I want to tackle, but yeah, either way, let's get started. So, okay, since this is an armor module, I'm going to base the graphic off of the original armor module, which I'm just going to open. Armor. What did I call it? Sure if I find the original one, but we can start with this one. Hi Tommy, good evening. Good to see you. So, okay, so where is the stuff here? Okay. So let me adjust the background color. And yeah, so the linked armor module will not come in several varieties, it will just come in one standard armor block. And I guess the general idea which I want to implement here is that the different modules which are adjacent to each other are indeed connected. I'm not entirely sure yet if I'm going to do this connected property here in the graphics directly, or if I'm going to make like an overlay which shows how the modules are connected, but I guess it's sort of what we can figure out later on. Okay, so in case you haven't seen the previous streams, I usually start by figuring out that the snapping does no longer work. This is sort of a transition. I don't know exactly what has caused this, but yeah, okay. Nice. So, yeah, I think the idea is that it automatically links to adjacent armor modules, so you do not have to manually like assign anything. And so the person who suggested it basically suggested that the damage should be equally distributed among all the modules which are linked, Well, not exactly. Actually, he suggested that it is distributed to the models which are directly adjacent. So if you have like a huge block of armor, it will only spread to the directly adjacent modules. I'm not exactly sure if I'm going to do it exactly like this. So we have some creative freedom regarding this, I guess. So I guess I'm just going to get started and we can figure out later on what the best way would be to implement this. Okay, so right now I'm just going to adapt this height map a bit. So basically I'm going to make some room so that we can have some connection stuff going on here. Other than that, it's going to look pretty similar to the original armor module, I think. Which is a bit lazy on the one hand, but on the other hand, the armor modules are usually not active modules, which should take up a lot of, visual clutter. So, I try to keep the modules which do not have an active role relatively simple. Okay. So, I guess my idea is that we have this sort of a connection going along the side, or maybe to the back, I'm not quite sure yet. Well, let's try a bit. Let's put this a little bit lower. Of a damage sink. That's actually a pretty good idea too. I'm not sure yet, so I guess just figure out. By the way, is the audio level okay? It picks up really high on this preview screen thingy, and I don't want to destroy your ears. Okay, let's do this part like this. Okay, thank you. Okay, so now I'm going to make like a small connection between these two. It should be a little bit lower. Or even better, we could make it like this, so that it extends beyond this part. Okay. Yeah, okay. So it adds a little bit more detail to the other modules. Okay. Not quite sure if this is going to look good. It may be a bit too complex already. Oh yeah, okay, maybe like this. And now this part a bit shorter. Wow, I need to catch up on chat. Wait a second. So basically, as you know right by now, my typical approach is the laziest approach possible. And so my idea on how to implement this damage spreading is pretty much the same which you suggest, which is that we have like a recursive sort of damage distribution. So if a module is damaged, we will scan how many adjacent modules we have and give each of these modules a proportion relative to the number of modules. And if this module is also linked armor, it will, you know, spread it again. So it will be like a Bernoulli board. Is it called a Bernoulli board? Wait a second. Bernoulli board. No, it's not a Bernoulli board. How is it called? Either way, even if I don't know the name, that is sort of the idea I'm going to go for as a first approach. I mean, we can still figure out if it doesn't work later on, but for now. Okay, just let me add two more of these linking type thingies. Maybe these are already a bit too bright. Is it not the laziest way? I mean, it's pretty lazy, I don't know. It's the first thing that came to mind. So, let me fix this shadow thing. And, okay. So let's try this as a first approach. Let's save it as linked armor. You may have already noticed that there is like zero consistency between British and American spelling. Yeah. Okay, 128. Okay. Let's export it. As impulse armor PNG, and let's go. What? It already exists? Oh yeah, it's linked armor, not impulse armor. Impulse armor was last week. Well, no, it was when was it? I think it was 2 weeks ago. Linked armor. The impulse armor. Okay. So, let's open it. Yeah, I guess you're right. That would be a bit more, even more lazy. Okay, let's give this guy a try. So let's turn it into norm. No, stupid. Let's use my magic script stuff. It's a just the brightness and the opacity of all these layers. I think there's still a bit too much contrast for my taste. So I think I'm going to make these link parts a little bit less less bright, so that they fade a little bit more into the background. Okay. So let's take these guys. A bit darker. Then we take these guys to make them a bit less less opaque. Okay, let's try again. And let's close this and let's reopen it. Yeah, I guess this is more like what I have in mind. Yeah, actually, I think this is going to be one of the easier modules to implement because all the code pieces already exist at one place or another. For example, searching for adjacent modules or processing damage or so. So I think it should be relatively easy. So again, let's overlay our spacey texture, which sometimes just doesn't work. Okay, yeah. Duplication. Around a bit. Okay. Next, let's make a duplicate of the original layer. Let's delete all these light layers. Color mask. Okay. Let's save this stuff. And I think this already looks sort of fine. The last thing which I want to do here is I want to make the brightness of the overall module sort of same for the, what is it, the other armor modules. Easy module, easy logic, more effects. Yeah, we can try, we can try. Do we have any suggestions how the effect should look like? I'm open at this point. Okay, so let's make this brighter so that it looks sort of like this guy. Oops. Maybe like this. A bit brighter still and a little less shadow on this layer. Okay, just a tiny bit brighter. Yeah, should select the right layer. Perfect. I just need to move the space texture a bit because it sort of interferes at this point. I'm not entirely sure, to be honest, if this is a good idea in the first place to have the space texture on top of everything, but yeah, I guess it's fine. Okay, so yeah, I'm sort of satisfied with how it looks. So let me export it. Have them flash starting from the hit module and propagate to neighbors. Yeah, that sounds pretty good. So there should be like a time delay when they get damaged, or should it just be the graphical? I mean, should the damage impact be immediate, or should it be like a little delay so that we can have this wave effect? But I like the idea. I like the idea. Link PNG. Okay. And now for the color mask, just pretty much fine like this. And finally, let's do the normal map. Yeah. By the way, I have actually implemented your idea of using. Wait a second. Is it using the smaller sample size normal maps? So previously I had like this huge normal maps, which resulted in a bit of a fuzzier looking normal map, but I've changed most normal maps to have this finer structure, which is actually really cool. So it was actually really good suggestion, because now it is easier to see like some details on these modules. So thank you again. Okay, let's try it like this. And okay, let's export the normal map. Well, let's add it to the game. So, abstract module. Like, what is it? Linked armor class. Next, we need to create linked armor. Let's start with the impulse armor. Let's call it linked armor. Let's remove all the stuff which we do not need at this moment. Okay. This controllable is active. Okay. Okay. Am I missing anything? Well, I need to add it to the research tree, but we can do this. After we have compiled it. Okay, so this part is sort of done. Can I make this smaller? No, I cannot. This part is also sort of done. I need to sort of. Okay, this is what we're working on right now. Let's do it like this. Okay. Yeah, actually, I really like this idea of having a wave going through your ship when you get damaged. So I'll try that. Okay, linked armor. Okay, so for testing purposes, let's make a ship. Which has a lot of linked armor. Linked armor test, let's remove all this stuff. So basically we're just going to have a lot of propulsion in the back, and our new linked armor module, which does not show up here for some reason. I guess we need to add it to the research tree in order for it to show up. Okay. Okay, so we have the Titan armor stuff, the shield array. Okay, so this is like the shield branch. And I guess I can add it to the impulse armor. Yeah, okay, that makes sense. Like from a lore perspective. Okay, so impulse armor, okay. So let's edit here, impulse armor and linked armor. Probably going to get confused many times with this. And let's make it a little bit more expensive. Yeah, okay. So now it should be in the game, unless I'm missing something. Is it really not called a Bernoulli board? Wait a second. Apparently not. Ah, it's a Galton board. Isn't that? Yeah, exactly. Okay. Yeah, exactly. So this is pretty much how I want the damage to be distributed and how Battlefleet Engineer suggested it. So basically you have these balls coming from the top and falling down this golden board. And on each intersection there's like a 50% chance of going to the left or going to the right. So these are like nails stuck on a board. And so this is how the damage is going to distribute if you do it like that. So spoiler alert, this is going to be the normal distribution if you, you know, have like really, really large number of balls falling down and really, really long golden board. Okay. Yeah, so this is like the knowledge bomb for this night. And let's continue. So first let's check if it's in the research tree. And it is, here it is. Ah yeah, it's still missing a name and description. But it should already be available. Linked armor test. Okay. Actually, we could shape it like a garden board, but that's a bit, I guess that's a bit too fancy. Okay. I actually sort of like how it looks. I mean, the ones here on the side, they sort of seem to connect. I mean, unfortunately, the ones here on the top do not, but I guess you cannot really have it always look correct, because you can also have these armor pieces stuck together like that. Okay, so maybe I can improve the color mask a bit so that the colors shine through a bit more. Yeah, wait a sec, I can just do that, I guess. So color mask was like this. I can make it a lot brighter like this, I guess. Okay. Okay. Good. Next, let me add the description and names for these modules. So that good part is done with. So impulse armor was here. Now we have linked armor. So the linked armor. I guess distribute is not really the best way for this, the best word for this. Just have a look at the dictionary. Spread, I guess spread is better. Yeah, spread is better. Better. Mm-hmm. Spread the part of the incoming damage to adjacent modules, okay. Let's add it to the German file as well. And also okay. Okay, so okay, so let me just recompile it so that the new files are in the game. Hi, Stavrid, good evening. How do you calculate chip collision damage? Yeah, I can show you. Collision damage, ship parts against an armor. Okay. I calculate the collision damage based on the impact. And in order to get the impact in this function, I need to collision manager something? No. Collision handler? No. Contact manager? Contact listener, yeah. Okay. So from the way I see it, JBox2D gives you this list of contact handlers. No, that's completely wrong. Wait a second. No impulses. Okay, so every time JBox2D detects a collision, this function is called. Yeah. And we get this impulse, this contact impulse object. And this contact impulse object has a number of impulses like this. I'm not entirely sure why it has multiple of them, but I just calculate the absolute value, add it all together, and the sum of all these normal impulses is what I call the impact velocity, or I guess impact strength would be more accurate. And I just forward it to this other function, which then multiplies it with a magic number and takes that as the damage. By the way, I did find a bug that some modules did no longer collide, which was a bit annoying. Let me just see if it is here. Mm. Yeah, well, I need to find that later on. Did I? Yeah, I actually did close the game. What? Whoops. Apparently the game did not start correctly, which is a bit annoying, because now I have to reset the settings. Okay. Nice. What did I change? I changed the color mask of the module. Yeah, which looks a lot better because like the colors are now more pronounced and change a lot more when you change them. Yeah, I guess that is a nice color for an armor module. And it also has correct name and description now. Okay, so next, let's add the functionality. Yeah, I guess you're right. I guess the multiple impulses do sort of indicate multiple contact points, but what I notice is that even if you have only one contact point, you can have multiple of these impulses, which I didn't really understand it, but I guess you're probably right about this. Maybe also missed it at some other point. Yeah. Sort of. Let me just spend a few seconds on finding this bug which I noticed earlier. So the bug was pretty much that if you play for some time and your ship gets damaged a lot, at some point you do not take collision damage anymore. Yeah, I guess I'm not going to find it right now. So, yeah. Okay, let's go back to the linked armor module. Yeah. Okay, so basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to override the damage function. Let's just have a look at the original damage function. Looks like this. So let's steal this and get like this. Okay. And next we need to steal the function for finding adjacent modules. So let's go to the, what was it called? The autoloader, I think. Okay, and the autoloader has a function called find connected module, and I guess we sort of need to steal this and extend it to the case which we need now. Okay, so how did it work here? So basically, we're going to the list of all modules, and we're going to make a point behind and see if this point is contained in the other module. Fair enough. Okay, so this is pretty much what we're going to do, except that we need to specify a lot more points. Should we do it the nice way or the ugly way? Let's do it the ugly way. So, 0 worked in this case because the autoloader module is 1x1. But since we have a 2x1 module, we need to go a bit to the left here and a bit to the right. Yeah, okay. So I think these would be modules which are behind. These should be modules which are in front. And now we only need modules which are left and right. I guess like this, okay. And another change which we have to do is previously we only had this function return one module which is connected to the autoloader. And now we need to return a list because the linked armor can obviously be connected to a number of modules. Okay. Here, instead of returning the module, we add the module to the list. Okay, so probably that's not... well, I mean, before we continue, let's just check if this already works. So, if the module gets damaged, let us just... see how many modules are connected to the armor module. Okay, I guess this is a reasonable first step. Isn't any collision damage in middle? Okay. Wait a second. Wait a second, why is it not compiling? Missing return statement. Ah, okay. I mean, since Farcia is based on JBox, I think the main... Yeah, so basically this underscore world is the JBox 2D dynamics world, and this function, I mean this class offers two functions, which are contact listener, set contact listener and set contact filter. So basically the contact filter specifies which modules, objects or fixtures can collide with each other, and the contact listener is the function or the object implementing the interface contact listener, which is called whenever stuff is colliding. So I guess, you know, just look for these functions in the Farcia API. Okay. Okay, so what should happen now is when we ram our ship into like an asteroid or so and we hit the front module, it should report that it is connected to two modules. So let's give it a try. Okay. So, asteroid coming up, and it worked, nice. So let's have a look at some other modules. Okay, this was a module here on the side, and these modules are connected to four modules. Yeah, that's correct, nice. A sort of didn't expect to get it working on the first try, but yeah, I'm not going to complain. So then let's continue. And now that we have our list of connected modules, I should really make this a bit more pretty. Actually, this is really sort of horrible. Oh well, whatever. Okay, and we also need to filter this list so that we only get other linked armor modules. Yeah, okay, good. So at this point we're going to skip every element that is... Are we going to take only the elements which are instance of... linked armor. So that the damage is not distributed to modules which are not linked armor. Okay. Okay. Okay, so I guess this part is going to be sort of easy. Connected count is the number of modules which are in this list plus the module which we are on at the moment. Make the float so that we do not run into problems later on. And next. I mean, this is actually relatively simple. For every module in the list of our connected modules, we damage the module by amount divided by connected count. And finally, we damage ourselves, also by this amount. Okay, now the only thing which we have to take into account is that we have to avoid like an infinite loop, because, you know, if we have like a couple of linked armor modules, like in our case, they would just recurse forever and distribute the damage all around forever. So instead, let's just make a threshold amount of damage. So if amount is smaller than, say, 0.25, then we're just going to immediately you know, assign the damage to this module. Otherwise, we are going to do that stuff. Okay. I think that looks sort of fair enough, so let's give it a try. Okay, what did I miss? Maybe I don't like this part. I should say, by the way, that in this mJava program language implementation, there are occasionally some bugs. So sometimes it will compile to Java code which is not correct. Yeah, this is one of the examples. I'm not quite sure why it was like that. Okay. So, let's give it a try. Will it work? Will it not work? Will it crash? Well, I'm not entirely sure, because it's a bit hard to see. Yeah, I think it does work. I mean, if you, I think the only way to really see it is here in the, you know, ship summary, ship status summary. And you can see that the front one is pretty much damaged, but also the modules behind are. And even this module, which is not on the outside, is also damaged. Yeah, so let's try a bit more, but actually pretty convincing already. Yeah, okay. I think it's working. I think it's working. I mean, even these modules, which are really on the inside, are now slightly damaged, while the front ones are almost destroyed. Pass the list of traveled modules. Yeah. Alternatively, we could... well, I mean, we want to make a graphical effect anyway. So, yeah, I guess we'll just see it using the graphical effect, but we can of course also we could also just make a printout, just to be sure. Yeah. Yeah, I guess we can check this print out next time. Okay, so I quite like your idea of doing the graphical effect. I'm not entirely sure how I would handle this. This time delay. So I guess for a start, I'm just going to begin by, so let's make a new variable, which is flash time, I guess. And flash time okay, I see. Yeah, I mean, I guess that would be an alternative approach to avoid doing this, but I mean, I sort of like the idea of this, where is it, golden board. So basically the module here in the middle would be the one which is hit, but there is some probability that the recursion will go back to that module. So I guess it sort of makes sense that there is also recursion, you know, back to the original module. Yeah. Okay. In a second, flash time. Okay. Okay, so for now, let's just make a variable flash time, which is given the amount of the damage the module has taken. We also have to make sure that this is reduced later on. And when we render the module, we need to have it flash whenever this variable is set. So let's steal code for a very simple overlay effect like this. Stealing it from the carrier module, which has a very simple graphic overlay effect. So, die ist Power. So, the power would now be minimum of run and flash time. I mean, this is probably going to look horrible, but it's a first try. Okay, let's make it so that it fills the whole module. Okay. So, let's give it a try. Make the damage distribution perfect and deterministic. But I mean, it sort of is, right? I mean, it is deterministic. I mean, it's not entirely sure what perfect would mean in this case. I mean, it's not like we're modeling a real life module or something. So let's see if okay, so that didn't work at all. That didn't work at all. Okay. What did we do wrong? Is actually used. Okay, power is okay. Actually, that was a bug. Is it also in the carrier module? Yes, it is. This is variable D, which is not used at all. I mean, it's not really a bug for the carrier module, but it was a bug here because the power variable is not used in the linked armor module. So they are glowing. They are glowing a very long time. And so the glow is very weak. So we need to make the glow weak, stronger. But we also need to make it go away faster. Okay, good. So let's make this not times 35%, but times 1. This is the alpha value, the opacity of the effect. And next, let's add amount divided by 10. Okay. So now it should be shorter and more intense. Really working, is it? I mean, all the effect on the other modules is so weak that it immediately disappears, but Maybe divided by 10 is too much. Let's make it divided by 3. Okay. And I guess we need to... I think this is not completely correct. This is not completely correct, I think. So first of all, if there is no connected module, so if the linked armor is alone, then it should take the full damage. Yeah. And next, if it is not alone, I wonder if it should just distribute the whole damage and not damage the module itself. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I guess this is how it should be. Because otherwise it will distribute more damage than there actually is, I think. I think. Okay. So let's give that a try, and it should also be brighter now, it should be visible for a longer amount of time, and I guess we can also print out this variable so that we can see how it works. Okay, good, let's get a try. Ah, by the way, I should check if... Okay, that part worked. Okay, so for a limited time, the game is 25% off. So yeah, good chance to get a deal if you haven't bought it already, or if you, you know, want to make a very nice gift for Easter. Well, it's a bit too late for that, but yeah, I get you get my point. So, so it's working. Okay, so now all these guys are bright. Okay, so the decay needs to be much, much faster. Okay, okay, so let's make the decay faster. Like 5 times as fast. Fading in reverse order, okay. Ah, okay. It's actually a pretty good point. Wait a second. What would be the easiest way to do that? Really strange. the module here in the middle got destroyed, not the ones on the outside. But I guess it makes sense if you collide from the side a lot. It's actually really interesting that the middle modules get destroyed before the outer ones. Fair enough, I guess. Yeah, how do we make the graphical effect? I'm sort of tempted to just make lightning effects from each module to each connected module. Wouldn't that sort of work? I mean, it's a bit, you know, inconsistent as it is not energy which is distributed, but I think it would be relatively easy and it would work sort of. Let me give that a try for a second, just to see how it would look like. So we had the same here at the linked armor module. No, the impulse armor. We had a lightning effect. Okay. Okay. Something like this. Okay. And just whenever we distribute damage to the module, we would add a new lightning effect. And point one would be the center point of this module. Point two would be the center point of the connected module. Let's write it like this so that it's more clear what we are doing. Let's see if how that would look like. I think the problem with doing the animation using the decay is that the decay sort of depends on the amount of damage taken. So I don't think that we can just take the flash time as... Okay, a second. So how does this look like? Whoa! Okay, so apparently there are like really, really many lightning effects going on at the same time. I guess the lightning isn't really made for these small things. But on the other hand, it sort of works. Why is it so strong? Why is the lightning effect so strong? Can we make it less strong? I mean, I guess we can if we spread this part out a bit. Maybe like this. Have two iterations. How would that look? Oh, I want the decay flash effect. I mean, I sort of want to give it a try. I'm not. Maybe I'm. Okay, so lightning effect doesn't really work. Okay. I mean, I guess I would have to to make many changes to how the lighting effect looks in order to make it look properly. Okay, so back to the flash effect. Save the list of damaged modules and use a custom flash effect that travels like a sine wave over the list. Yeah, I guess. So this is so weird to program because this damage function is called both on the original module as well as on every module in the chain. So, okay. Yeah, okay. So this is going to be really ugly, but yeah. Obviously, I want to. Okay, so my idea is the following. The first entry here for the hash map is going to be the time point at which the module is first hit and the first damage occurs. And then we just collect all the modules which are damaged at the same time point. So it's not going to work if we have multiple collisions occurring at the same exact frame. But other than that, we should be able to, you know, put all the modules into this list and then calculate the effect based on the position in the list. I guess that should work. That should work, I guess. Maybe it's more complicated than it needs to be. Okay. Every time we distribute damage, actually every time we get into this function, we check if flash map contains key world time. No, the other way around. If it does not contain the current time, we put it into the list and create a new list of modules. Okay, and then if the flash map does not. Oh, this is really ugly, sorry. So if the flash map for this point in time does not contain this module, then we add this module. Stress. Okay. And when we add it, and then if we do this, we can get the position. That way we'll find out which, wait a second, does it even work? It does not work. It does not work because this is recursive and the first module which is hit will, this is so ugly. This is so ugly. I guess we can, okay. Okay, no, let's not do it like this. Instead, we can save, okay, yeah, that makes more sense. Instead of saving the whole list of stuff, we can just change, save the amount of damage received by the first module, and using that we can look at the amount of damage we have here in relation to the amount which is stored, and the lower this relation is, the further along we are in the chain. Yeah, that sort of makes sense. So let's call it like ratio, and this is just the amount divided by map get time. Okay, and then we can determine the position like in the animation based on this ratio. But first, let's test if it works at all. That part. Okay. Okay. I think it's sort of working. Okay, yeah. And we just have to make sure what happens if, I mean, every module is multiple times in this damage function, so we have to take only the first one. Okay. It's graph time, I think. Let's make like test image. So let me just illustrate what I'm trying to do. in like the shittiest graphic ever. So, so this is on the vertical axis. This is going to be the strength of the flash effect, and this is going to be the ratio, which will change over time. And what I want is, first of all, I need like 1 minus the ratio, because the ratio starts with 1. So 1 is the highest ratio, which is hit by the original module. And that should be like here, and then it should fade away. While other modules, which have like 0.5 or so, should start empty and be like that, I guess. Okay, yeah. Sort of should look like that. And let's make like a variable which is flash time. I guess we already have flash time, so we just have to define it differently. And flash time is now 1 minus ratio. So if the ratio is 1, then flash time is 0. Actually, let's make it. Okay. So let's make it new flash time, and we only assign new flash time if flash time is smaller than 0, or new flash time is smaller than flash time. And we assign flash time to new flash time. I guess, yeah. And every time step, we reduce flash time by like dt. And this should be like absolute of flash time. No. Okay, let's start with this. Okay, I'm trying to do way too many things at once, which makes it much more complicated than it needs to be. Okay. Yeah, you are correct. I think multiple flashes would not be supported by this solution. Would they? I think they would if there's a little bit time between, I think. Okay, so okay, so let me zoom in a bit. So there is already a wave effect, it's like completely wrong. And the first module isn't like flashing at all. Yeah, okay. Why is it wrong? This is flash time times 1. Okay, yeah. Yeah, okay. So basically, I want to have this kernel stuff. Guess GIMP is not like the mathematics package of choice. So now this is flash time, and this is going to be the strength of the effect. And if this is zero, I want it to be like this. Yeah. So when we move along with time, it will get bright and then it will decay. Very good point. Very good point. Using global time. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Very good. Very good. It's actually much more much more, much better. Then we do not need this crap. And here we can just, yeah. It's actually way better. So, flash time is. World time plus 1 minus ratio. Yeah. Okay. And okay, so if flash time is smaller than zero, I guess this is redundant. So if the flash time is in the past, so if it has already flashed before, then we need to reassign it. Or if flash time is larger than this. Okay, yeah. Yeah. Okay. So basically the reason for this is that this function will get called multiple times. And we want to have the largest ratio have the effect. Yeah. So we want to make it flash as early as possible. Okay. And I guess we can also add like a little bit of extra time. Well, we have to see how it looks later on. Okay. And now here we have. We calculate the absolute difference of the flash time and world time and restrict it to values greater than zero. Yeah, it's actually way better, way better. And we don't need this restriction, I guess. I mean, yeah, I guess it's a little bit. Let's make it into a variable so that we do not need to call this function if there is nothing to draw. I guess we do not need this maximum function also. The other way around, only if strength is positive, only then do we do it. Ah, oh, wait, this isn't correct, right? Yeah, it needs to be 1 minus the. Okay, let's just test it. If flash time is equal to world time, this is 0 and it will evaluate to 1. If flash time is 1 larger than the time, then it should be 0. If it is even larger, it should also be 0. and the other way around should work too. Okay. Give it a try. Okay. Whoa. It immediately crashed. Does it have to do with the... Yeah, it does. Render top has crashed. Okay. Well, okay. I guess there's a time when world is not defined. So we have to skip it if there's no world, I guess. It's actually the only reason I could imagine how this gives a null pointer exception. Well, okay, why not, why not? I mean, to be completely honest, I'm not sure anymore which objects can be null or not. So for example, if world can be null or if ship part can be null. It's really horrible. I mean, some of them are null, for example, if you're in the editor or if you have just started a mission in the first frame or so. So, yeah. I actually should know, but... I guess it works. So let me zoom in and read some stuff. Yeah, okay, if you hit multiple stuff, it's pretty ugly. But here, yeah, very nice. So, I guess we can make it faster. We can make it more flashy. Yeah, but other than that, very nice, very nice. So, let me just make the kernel here a bit tighter by and by kernel I mean the width of this function here by multiplying this with 5. Okay, yeah, that's pretty much it. Yeah, yeah. Use the ratio to vary the intensity. Yeah. Good point. What? Okay, I guess now the kernel is a bit too small because now we are getting gaps between the different modules. Oh, and also the effect does not cover the full module, I think. So it should be a bit, yeah. Okay, so let's make this part a bit. So first let's make the kernel a bit wider again. Then let's make the effect a little bit bigger than it was previously, like 50% bigger, I guess. Yeah, and good point. Let's make, flash strength, and let's make flash strength equal to the ratio, for example, and let's multiply flash strength with this part. Okay. Yeah, Now the first round should indeed be brightest. Maybe we need to apply a little bit of a transformation here, because the ones down in the chain will be really, really weak. But let's see. So I'm thinking of taking like the square root of the ratio, for example, which might make sense. I don't know. Okay. So, whoops. What's happening? Ah, okay. So, my mouse was out of focus, so it kept moving forwards. Okay. Yeah, I guess. It sort of works. I can, yeah, okay. So first of all, let me transform this ratio by using the square root, so that the fall off isn't quite as strong. So again, let me draw it. So basically, before, the fall off was like this, and now the fall off should be more like that, which is exactly how square root looks like. And next, yeah, I want to sort of divide this by two so that the effect is a little bit shorter. I mean, obviously, these are all magic numbers, so there's no reason why it should be exactly the way I chose them. Clamp the strength. Yeah, this is pretty much what my intention is with the square root function. So let's try this guy. Yeah, I guess it sort of works. Because I want to increase the overall strength a bit, which I could do. But other than that, I wonder, is it actually correct that it is always the middle module which gets destroyed first? Is it correct? I guess we can do some theory crafting too. Maybe can we use to set non-zero minimum? Non-zero minimum. What exactly? What variable exactly do you mean? What part would you clamp? Not quite sure. So first of all, so let me try doubling the strength of the effect. Yeah, actually. sort of like it. It's a little bit strange if you hit multiple times. So maybe I should improve on that, but and maybe I should make it even faster. Yeah, I guess that I should do. So let's take like 0.25. Okay. Flash strength would never be less than 0.4. Okay. Yeah, okay. Great. Good point. Good point. Let's try it like this. Let's try it like this next time. I'm going to try the clamping approach in a minute, but I'll take a very, very brief break. So I'll be back in like 5 minutes. Oh, yeah. Okay. 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 So there are basically two more things I would like to do. First of all, I'm going to try a suggestion of having this clamp of the strength. And then I'm going to make a ship which is more a bit more realistic, like a ship which has this armor going all around it, and see how it looks and how it works. so embarrassing to be out of breath after, you know, walking a few stairs. I really need to do some more sports when the weather gets better. Okay. Oops. Okay. I think it works, sort of. Okay, however, I think I need to make the kernel tighter again now that I have changed the time here. So let's make this like 0.3 and this like 4, I guess. And instead of doing the clamping like this, I would like to have it linearly like this. Okay, good. So that there's still some bit of a gradient or like a bit of an effect of the ratio on the effect strength. Okay, I'm guessing 0.4 is a bit too strong. I guess. But I think the overall time, I mean the speed of the effect is sort of okay. Yeah, it does look a bit strange if you have multiple impacts in a short period of time. Okay. And what did I want to change? I think now it's a bit too bright. I'm not entirely sure why. Maybe the times 2 is not so good. It's like 0.15, and let's make it a bit smaller still, the kernel, I mean. Meantime, I can close this. I can close this. Save this part. Thank you, Ikebot. Okay, I'm guessing this is going to get my seal of approval. Now I'm just going to make one final try, which is also the effect shouldn't be on in the editor. Actually, what is it here? So now world time is 0 and flash time is 0, which is why it is flashing. So let's just make flash strength 0, I guess. Okay. Okay, so flash map was required here, I guess. Actually, is the flash map still required? Yeah, it is because okay, yeah, it is. It is. Okay. And we should make flash time like default to minus 5 or something so that it doesn't occur when the time is not zero. Yeah, exactly. How does it look like if we have a long chain? So this is going to be our next test. So it is a valid chip design, so why not? Okay. So it doesn't transfer infinitely. Okay, I guess it makes sense. If we have some like more impact, it should have a longer effect. Oh, we can also try the mines. That would be fun. Okay, so the mines do a lot more damage, so the ripple effect is longer. Okay, and we can also try ramming at a high speed, which should also result in a lot of damage. Yep, okay. Yeah, nice. I guess the only thing which is not so nice is when you have multiple contact points. I guess it doesn't really happen so often. I guess it looks okay, even if you have these effects. I'm wondering, however, if the clamping is really so good because now we have like a really strong break between the last module, which is damaged, and the module next to it. Yeah, exactly. Exactly, so the idea behind the linked armor, which we are doing today, is that the damage is distributed evenly to the adjacent modules. So it's a nice variation on the original armor. Ah, by the way, we should fix like the basic balancing of this. So the standard armor. Okay, so it is a bit more expensive than the standard armor, which makes sense, I guess. I guess we can make it 2.5. Yeah. So it's like one. I don't know, it's a bit more expensive than the normal Titan armor. What did I want to change? I want to try like a weaker sort of clamping and see if this looks better. This is better. This is Protama seems quite effective. I guess you mean S? This is S Protama? Yeah. This is happening so fast, it's hard to see. We need mines, I guess. Do we have mines on this map? No, we do not. Oh, actually, we could just. Wait a second. Yeah, that should work. I mean, we do not need asteroids for damage. So. Okay, so without the clamping, the effect is sort of weak. So, I guess if we do clamping, we need to make the effect stronger. Okay, so let's try 200% again. And afterwards, I guess we are sort of ready to deploy it and put it in the game. Yeah, I sort of like it like this, I guess. Maybe, okay, maybe I should use the ratio for the time, but not for the strength, I guess, yeah. Let me try this. I mean, I like the square root for the time, but I think the fall off at the end is too strong, which causes this extreme clamping. I can move myself by shooting at the armor. good point, actually. Wait a second. Yeah, I guess you're right. I guess you're right. So I guess like the collision impact should be as big as. Yeah, I see. I see. Yeah, I guess you're right. I guess there's a slight bug in the in the physics here. Okay. Yeah. So, I'm sort of satisfied with it. I guess it may even be a bit too strong, the armor. I mean, balance-wise. Because you have like a lot of hit points between all these linked armor modules. I guess I should make them a little bit less, yeah. Let me reduce the hit point number a bit, because this is a bit too strong, I think. So it shouldn't be much more expensive than the original Titan armor, but it shouldn't be as strong. So let's give it 80 hit points instead of 120. Yeah. Yeah. Even versus others, magic numbers are not accurate.